Hey folks, so this is section 8.2 dealing with the law of cosines. So just one slight note here, the triangle side length restriction. In any triangle, the sum of the lengths of any two sides has to be greater than the length of the third side. So any two sides in a triangle, when you add them up, has to be greater than the third side. Otherwise, you've got a side that's too short to make a triangle. All right, the law of cosines. Notice that there's three laws here, but they're all the exact same law. They all start with a side that is squared. They all end with an angle. And notice that we have here that the side on this end and the angle on this end have the same name. The sides that are used in the middle are the other two sides. So here, again, you're starting with side B, you're ending with angle B, and it's sides A and C that are used in the middle. All right, so using the law of cosines, let's take a look at example one, which just starts out as a story problem. So you have two boats that leave a harbor at the same time. And they travel on courses that make an angle of 82 degrees 20 minutes in between them. When the slower boat traveled 62.5 kilometers, the faster one traveled 79.4 kilometers. And at that time, the question is, what's the distance between the boats? So let's go ahead and take some time here to draw what we have. So we have two boats. They leave the harbor at the same time. So let's call this right here our harbor. One of our boats goes in this direction, and the other boat goes in this direction, and the two are 82 degrees, 20 minute angle between them. So let's say that this is the slower boat down here. Whoops, I didn't mean to use an eraser on that. And so we'll call it boat B, the slower boat, is 62.5 kilometers is the distance that one traveled. The faster one, we'll call it boat A, and it traveled 79.4 kilometers. And the question is what is the distance between the two boats? And in letters, we would call that lowercase h because it's opposite angle h. All right, so let's go ahead then and let's set up a chart like we have for section 8.1 as well. And we'll notice that there is no possible way that I can use the law of sines on this because of the fact that I don't have a full fraction. I don't have two known pieces of information. Sorry, I keep somehow touching my eraser. All right, so let's go ahead then. We can use the law of cosines. You say, well, which of the law of cosines should we use? Since we only have one angle, we'll use the one that uses that particular angle. All right, so let's go ahead and I wrote a new one because I didn't have anything with H's and just replaced my H's, my C's with H's. And then we can plug in our numbers. At this point, I have enough information to just simply plug in this whole entire string of numbers into my calculator. And when I do that, I get this really large number, 8,000 something number. But remember, this is h squared, and I actually need distance h. So let's take the square root of that number. And that gives us this 94.26. And we'll go ahead and use significant figures here to say that the distance between the boats is 94.3 kilometers. All right, let's jump down then to example number two. Now, beside example number two, I have some notes here. So let's take a look at these notes before I jump into example number two. The first note says that when we use the law of sines, it is not able to find us an obtuse angle. We would have to use adding and subtracting. Remember that the reason for that is because of the restrictions for sine inverse. All of our obtuse angles would be in quadrant 2, but sine inverse can only find us a quadrant 1 angle. So that's the problem there. If we're using the law of sines and we need to find an obtuse angle, we would have to use adding and subtracting. However, the law of cosines is able to find obtuse angles because the law of cosine inverse, its restriction is the top half. So it can find those obtuse angles for us. The third note is that if you do your math correctly, the law of cosines, which is the harder of the two laws, should only ever have to be used one time per triangle. If you do your math right, the harder law should only have to be used once. All right, so let's take a look here at example number 2. You'll notice that I've already filled out my chart with the information I've been given. And once again, you'll notice there is no possible way to use the law of sines because I don't have a full fraction of numbers. So let's go ahead then and use the law of cosines. You say, well, which law of cosines should I use? Well, in this case, we really don't have a choice. You're going to use the one where you've been given an angle. All right, so we're going to start out with the b squared law. And we'll go in and we will plug in all of our numbers. Now, you'll notice on this particular... this one is almost identical to the last question. I can take what we know right here and I can plug the entire string of numbers into my calculator. And I'll get this 47 number. Notice that is not what I got in my calculator, but I already took the square root. So just watch that. I didn't show all of my work on that. All right, so that will give me side B then. I'll use my significant figures to round. All right, so now I still need to find angle A and angle C. Now, so here's where I'm going to use the note that I just mentioned that the law of sines cannot find an obtuse angle. So when I look at my chart, is one of my angles, is it possible that it is obtuse? Could angle A be obtuse? Could angle C be obtuse? And in order to answer that question, you're going to look at your sides because remember, small opposite small, medium opposite medium, large opposite large. Since this is my largest of the three sides, this has to be my largest angle. That means angles A and C are going to be acute, and I will not be looking for an obtuse angle. So I don't have to worry about which angle I decide to go looking for first. All right, with that said then, let's use the law of sines. We'll find angle A, my unknowns go on top. You'll notice that when I use this, I am not using the rounded version. I'm using the whole string of numbers that would have been in my calculator. So whether that's because you stored it or just simply because that's the last number that was on your screen, just make sure that that you use all of the decimals. Go ahead and isolate the sine of angle A. You'll get 0.57. Go ahead and use sine inverse then to find angle A, which is going to be 34.9 degrees. And then I didn't even show my work, but to find angle C, we know that we'll just do 180 minus angles A and B. All right, moving on then to example number 3. So for example number 3, you'll notice that I was given 3 sides. I don't know any angles. Okay, so once again, law of sines is out of the question. There's no way I can use the law of sines. Law of cosines has to be used. You say, well, which law of cosines do I have to use? Since I'm using the law of cosines, and since the law of cosines is able to find obtuse angles, I'm going to look for the angle that might be obtuse. And when I take a look here at my sides, angle C is the angle that might be obtuse. All right, so we're going to go find angle C first because we're using the law of cosines. So here we go. Let's go ahead and use this particular law. Let's plug in all of our values. Notice that I cannot plug in this whole entire string because I have an unknown right here. So the first thing I'm going to want to do is let's subtract these two guys on both sides and move these two over to the left side. And then you'll notice that according to order of operations, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to divide by these three. Now, one thing to consider when you're plugging this into your calculator, just make sure that you put parentheses around the entire top and around the entire bottom. Otherwise, your calculator will think you're trying to do something different and you will have inputted it incorrectly. You will also get an incorrect answer. All right, so we'll go ahead then and plug that into our calculator, and then we'll do inverse cosine, and we get what was an obtuse angle, 118.5610, and we'll use significant figures there. Now what you notice is that I have enough information that I can use the law of sines because I have a full fraction worth, and I didn't even hide this to show you, so I'll just point it out. Here is my law of sines. I'm finding angle B next. It doesn't matter which angle I find because I've already found my obtuse angle, and you can't have more than one. So angle B then is this 39 number, and then I'll be able to use adding and subtracting to find my angle A, which is the 22.1 degrees. All right, example number four is more of a story problem, a picture problem. Once again, your picture tells you that you have three sides, and we're asked to find angle C. Now, folks, we're only asked to find angle C. So normally, if I were asked to solve the entire triangle, I would have found angle A first because it might be obtuse. But because we're only asked to find angle C, that's exactly what I'm going to do, is only find angle C. So I'll go ahead then and use my law of cosines that finds angle C. We'll plug in the numbers that we have. Once again, you want to subtract these two from both sides, and after you do that, you'll want to divide by these three. Go ahead and plug in. Just don't forget that you need a parentheses around the entire top and around the entire bottom. This will give you the decimal of 0.57. Find your inverse cosine, and that's going to be this 54 number. It does say that we should go to the nearest degree, and so that will be 55 degrees approximately. The next chart, the first two are actually review from section 8.1, where we walked through case one that had two angles and a side, and case two, which was our ambiguous case. We spent a long time and many videos on that. Case three and case four are both for the law of cosines. So what do? If you have two sides and an angle, you find the third side by using the law of cosines, and then you find the other two using the law of sines. If you know three sides, find the largest angle using the law of cosines, and then find one of your other angles using the law of sines, and then you can use adding and subtracting to find the third angle. All right, and then we also have one more area formula to learn here. This one is for when I have three sides given to me. Remember in the in section 8.1, the area that we had was for two sides and the included angle, and this one is for three sides. We're going to use Heron's formula. And so Heron's formula is two steps. Number one, you've got to find the semi-perimeter, which is literally half of the perimeter. Perimeter would be where we add all the sides together, so we're going to take half of that. And then to find the area of our triangle, we'll take the square root of the semi-perimeter times semi-perimeter minus side A, semi-perimeter minus side B, semi-perimeter minus side C. All right, so this is pretty simple. We'll just go ahead and do this one really quickly. The distance as the crow flies from Chicago to St. Louis is 262 miles. I got to tell you, I did have to look up on a map what this looked like because I don't know my geography as well as I should. From St. Louis to New Orleans is 599 miles, and from New Orleans to Chicago is 834 miles. What is the area of the triangular region having these three cities as vertices? So step number one, let's find our semi-perimeter, which is going to be 847.5. And then I will plug into the Heron's equation there. For the record, I actually stored this number in my calculator so that all I had to do was type in alpha S instead of typing in 847.5. Yes, that is a little bit on the lazy side. All right, when I do that, I'm going to get this very large number of 40,800 some. And we are, let's see, does it say anything about rounding? It doesn't look like it does, so we'll just go with significant figures then and round to the nearest whole. So that'll be 40,800 square miles. Just remember, with area, you are always dealing with square units. All right, that wraps up section 8.2.